Ah, SpongeBob SquarePants, Battle for Bikini Bottom. The next game Johnny would pull from the box for the Donators Marathon. Will Johnny have to endure another lackluster licensed game for the sake of his subscribers? Or perhaps this will be the first of many diamonds in the rough. There's that feeling of deja vu again. This is the third game in a row I'm reviewing that's based off of something related to either television or movies. Maybe it was meant to be. But I was a really big SpongeBob SquarePants fan growing up. I thought the show was gonna suck royally when I saw the teaser for it back in 1999, but the first three seasons are some of the best stuff I've ever watched from Nickelodeon, and I'm still laughing at them today. It was such a tightly written cartoon. I don't watch the show anymore now, I sort of stopped after the first movie came out. It's still going strong from what I can tell, it's good to see people still watch it, even if I myself do not. Love the show, didn't really play any of the games except one, I think it was Super Sponge for the Game Boy Advance. I don't remember much of it, I don't think it was bad, it was just probably nothing stunning.
Now I've heard things about this game, that it was actually a decent SpongeBob game. I was able to go in this time cautiously optimistic, but the bottom line is what this video is all about.
When you've played a game based off of a cartoon you've personally watched religiously, you observe how dialogue and animated cutscenes aren't of the same quality as the show. Yeah, SpongeBob SquarePants was a two-dimensional cartoon, and I'll praise the model quality of SpongeBob and the gang. I wish Mr. Krabs didn't look constantly stoned, and Barnacle Boy looks more like a puppet than a retired sidekick. This looks good for a PlayStation 2 title, but as a SpongeBob game, animation-wise, I think it feels stilted, and the writing didn't make me laugh a whole lot.
I think I have fudge in my pants.
Yeah, thank you for that. Now, most of my smiles and chuckles stem from the visual design, which were usually packed with tons of references to the show. During my encounter with the King Jellyfish, I was waiting for him to put on some football gear and start tackling me. I was giggling the entire time King Neptune was on the screen because I loved him in the King Neptune Spatula episode, and when I approached the vending machine on the rock bottom level, I was delighted to see the last bust of Bikini Bottom appear and then suddenly take off. I really think there's something here for fans to enjoy when it comes to the visual humor. For the game itself, that depends on if you like the standard 3D collectathon platformer, because that's what Battle for Bikini Bottom is, and it doesn't do much new with the formula. Plankton has amassed an army of robots, but forgets to set the obedience switch to obey, and now the robots are running amok all over Bikini Bottom. Meanwhile, SpongeBob and Patrick wish they had real robots to play with, and attempt to use Patrick's magic wishing shell to make that a reality. I think you know where this is going. So SpongeBob, along with Patrick and eventually Sandy, team up to thwart the robot menace, collecting golden spatulas along the way because they're needed to enter the chum bucket, the source of the problem. The golden spatulas are a reward for our heroes whenever they complete a task. Power stars, in other words. Using all three characters effectively is key to collecting the golden trinkets, but that's not to say they're vastly different. They can all double jump, they feel like they move at around the same speed, they attack enemies in pretty much the same fashion, they're mostly just separated by one or two maneuvers. SpongeBob gets the most attention, which should come as no surprise. He can super jump in a straight line to take care of aerial threats, and at some point he can throw a bubble bowling ball and even get a guided bubble missile to wreck someone's ship. Considering the amazing things SpongeBob can create with bubbles in the show, sticking with only a bowling ball and a missile is sort of lame for the dude. I thought SpongeBob was the one with
imagination.
Patrick is a little stronger, and he can throw objects like watermelons to flick switches or snipe an enemy from a distance. Sandy can grapple onto Texas icons to swing to new locations and somehow glide with her lasso. Even though SpongeBob gets the most love with his selection of moves, I like playing as Sandy the most. A standard glide and grappling lasso aren't as over the top as a bubble missile, I realize, but they're very practical for a platformer. I feel I can do a lot with Sandy, whenever the game allows me to select her anyway. You switch characters by using bus stops, but Patrick and Sandy aren't always available for specific missions, which I find a little disappointing. SpongeBob is a proficient little sponge, he can get the job done, but when you have to start using his upgrades all the time in the later half of the game, I'm struggling a bit. This rolling power-up right here, it controls like shit. Somebody didn't play Super Monkey Ball, I ignore it unless it's mandatory to get a spatula, Jesus Christ. The bowling ball attack is uncooperative. You gotta hold the button down to aim for a bit, so it's not very quick on the draw, and what I think is the worst part, he slowly tippy-toes forward while you're aiming your shot, making it more difficult for me to be accurate when they're asking me to hit switches on a rotating floor. The bubble missile isn't so bad, I like this ability as a long-range attack. Some of these enemies are just too annoying to deal with up close, you know? I wish you can slow it down, you know, like how remote control Batarang in the Arkham series works. It only has one speed, and the analog input is a bit on the sensitive side, so overshooting or just plain fucking missing could be an ongoing occurrence. SpongeBob's default moveset is more often than not capable when eliminating foes as the subject. A lot of these robots put up no challenge, often going down with a simple spin, a Viking jump, or a bubble stomp. Battle for Bikini Bottom is pretty easy throughout. Besides the aforementioned robots, you have infinite lives, a generous checkpoint system, and even the boss battles have easy-to-decipher strategies. Having the choice to warp to different areas to reduce backtracking between Golden Spatula missions is a great feature. If you miss something along the way, you can just pause the game, select the mission, and there you go. That's not even counting the warp boxes plastered to the humongous worlds. It's a licensed kids game, a functional one at that, so keeping things simple and going by the numbers was to be expected. That includes the one or two times where everything gets a little crazy and it makes you wonder if you're even playing the same game anymore. It started with the Mermalair for me. This ginormous Rube Goldberg machine got my blood boiling for a bit trying to get this damn ball inside this thing while having to use the bowling ball under a time limit. But I sort of had a harder time with this sequence, getting Patrick and this watermelon across these tilting platforms to hit this switch. And because Patrick can't jump while holding something, you need to throw the fruit at precise points and be quick about the whole thing because the fruit inexplicably explodes after a while. Oh, fuck off. You're telling me that didn't count? What a pile of Alaskan bullworm. Kelp Forest, what a confusing visual bore. There's no magic concha to make things better. Something's wrong here when this place has more advanced darkness than rock bottom. I can just barely make out what I'm jumping on. I had to turn the brightness up on my TV to progress at some points. You're moving back and forth a lot too within the same missions, needing SpongeBob to do this one thing and then switching to Patrick to do this other thing and then switching back to SpongeBob and then Patrick. Ugh. The dream world I enjoy for the aesthetics alone. The setting allowed the developers to go nuts with the visuals and I think it works, except for all the shit in Sandy's dream, could have gone without that. But I hate it, Mr. Krabs Dream, an onslaught of enemies in a tiny area and they can sneak up on you at any time. I'm not in the middle of pre-hibernation week, you assholes! I was gonna skip this one and just move on, that is until I accidentally discovered this hidden platform next to the arena when I wanted to kill myself to refill my health. Ironic, I know. Now I can pick them off with a bubble missile and make up for all that shit I went through. This damn game has knockback, and you really feel that shit when you're slammed in midair. The sight of a human hand taking me back to where I fell is funny, but only a few times. God damn! My apologies if I can't thoroughly explain this bit properly. I think the game looks fine, but there's something about the color choice I find both lively and bleak at the same time. Like, even in the jellyfish fields, there seem to be what I call dark patches that wash out the entire picture, doubly so for downtown Bikini Bottom. Need I bring up Kelp Forest again? Perhaps a cel-shaded approach would have brought out the cartoonist nature of the series in a better fashion. I tend to think that a lot when 2D cartoons are given 3D games. Battle for Bikini Bottom, aside from the SpongeBob SquarePants coat of paint, is a standard 3D platformer. You collect stuff to get the important stuff and use the important stuff to unlock other areas to continue collecting more stuff. I love the checkpoint system, I love the visual humor like I said before, but I've played this sort of game plenty of times beforehand. And when you've already reviewed Super Mario 64, I begin to focus on what other games and franchises do to stick out from the crowd, and I don't think Battle for Bikini Bottom does much of that, so I feel there's no real need to get very deep into it. Fans of SpongeBob SquarePants can find something to enjoy here, and I'm sure kids will love it, even if it is nearly 12 years old nowadays.
And once again, a very special thanks to Wayne, or Fliglava, it's written in parentheses here, I'm guessing that's a YouTube username or something like that. It was very nice of you, dude, to donate this game for us, and I'm sure with the guys over at SGB can get some mileage out of this, get a laugh and all of that. I hope you don't mind if I get a CD case for this. I was never really big on the GameStop, like, used slip-on covers, so I want to give this CD a proper home and, you know, do that. I'm like that. I'm sorry if you take that the wrong way. And as always, guys, you can find me here next week with the next video for the Donators Marathon. Same time, same place. Have yourselves a great night. Thank you for watching, and take care.
And so, another game finished for the Donators Marathon. But what Johnny doesn't know is that this latest adventure for him is just beginning. Oh, he has no idea. Thank you.